Lorsqu'on demande à des chercheurs de définir la biodiversité,
when researchers are asked to define biodiversity, they come up with different definitions. The most conventional one is the following: biodiversity is the diversity of living beings on three levels: the specific level, the ecosystemic level, and the genetic level. This is the definition that was provided in the 90s, and in the meantime, ecologists have introduced intermediate levels of diversity. Other researchers focus on the fact that biodiversity refers to current diversity, but also past diversity, or else they will insist that biodiversity is an evolutionary process. There are several different definitions depending on the researchers, but I'm thinking of another definition, the one that was chosen by Bernard Chevassieu-Louis, former president of the Museum of Natural History. In his lectures, he said biodiversity is a new vision on living beings emerging in the 70s and supported by a scientific community, conservation biologists. In this new vision, there are four main elements: immensity, fragility, complexity, and usefulness of nature. Biodiversity is a term that only appears in 1986 following a conference organized by this community and the report of which will be published by Edouard Wilson under the term biodiversity. In order to look at the various levels, we can use the definition, the analysis suggested by André Micou, based on medieval philosophy, according to which there are three main levels in if we try to understand the world: the intelligence of sensitive things, rational things, and mystical things. Which means, in other words, in modern words, that things can be analyzed in a sensitive dimension, a rational dimension, or an axiological dimension. And if we apply this analysis to biodiversity, it means that biodiversity is a percept, evocative of emotions, perceptions, a concept, which is evocative of an abstract idea, and a precept. So biodiversity is very well, it must be conserved, and we have to set up the tools to conserve biodiversity. But these three dimensions were present ever since the emergence of the word biodiversity. The conceptual dimension we've already mentioned, I'm not going to go over that again. The perceptual dimension, biodiversity as a percept. We understand it if we think that conservation biologists are not just researchers living in laboratories or offices, but they are experienced naturalists and they spend time on the field. They are very close to nature, and some of them who can write also like to write books. And to repeat philosopher Catherine Larère, they defend ecology in the first person. Robert Pyle, an entomologist, described the way in which his experience in nature made him develop a strong attachment to nature. And in a document called The Extinction of Experience, he underlines that as an ecologist, as an entomologist, he is interested in global extinctions, but he also thinks it is important to consider local extinctions perceived on the human scale, because they may lead to experience extinction in nature, and this might break the deep attachment that people like him have developed towards nature. Biodiversity as a precept. This is an idea which appears in the book coordinated by Edward Wilson, Biodiversity, which I mentioned earlier. One of the chapters is dedicated entirely to deciphering the values of biodiversity. Those who wrote in the chapter are economists and philosophers who have been asked to write on this subject in order to to explain objective values of biodiversity in the economic and moral dimensions. This bearing in mind that we need to convince politicians of the importance of conserving biodiversity. This was my preamble. I wanted to simply set the record straight so that you understand that biodiversity is not only a scientific concept, it's also a percept and a precept. And we know the success achieved because biodiversity was accepted on the agenda of the policies of nature with the Rio conference in 1992, with huge repercussions on the way that nature conservation policies were framed on the national level. Now, I would like to move on and focus on something else. As soon as biodiversity posed itself as the framework, sort of obligatory crossing, it was appropriated by a number of writers and sometimes led to heated debate and controversy. I would like to comment an article written by Arturo Escobar, a Colombian anthropologist, who in the 90s performed an analysis after the Rio conference on the way in which the word biodiversity can be used by multiple players. Biodiversity is first and foremost something that is discussed by environmental NGOs and the World Bank and such institutions. It's a liberal way of optimizing genetic resource management on the international scale, encouraging the flow between countries in order to facilitate economic exploitation and economic leveraging of these resources. This is compatible with instruments such as property, intellectual property rights, facilitated access and sharing of advantages as is found in the convention. It's also a category supported by Southern Hemisphere countries, those where the greatest species diversity can be found. In the framework of international negotiations, they gathered in a group of megadivers, as they call themselves, in order to play a greater role in geopolitical strategies. The category is also used by progressive NGOs in Latin America.
Donc catégorie mobilisée comme le support d'un discours critique vis-à-vis des formes actuelles de développement.
Like the support for a critical opinion versus those who are too profit-oriented. And is having detrimental consequences on nature and the protection of diversity. The NGOs promote a contrario, forms of development which are more diversity logic oriented. Finally, this is also a leverage which is used by local and indigenous communities in order to support their claims for political autonomy on the territories they occupy. The Convention on Biological Diversity especially framed the famous Article 8J, which recognizes the positive contribution made by indigenous people and populations to the maintenance and enrichment of biodiversity, contains a lever for action which is very meaningful. The typology was suggested at the end of the 90s, and the reference framework was the Latin American continent. Here we have the actors, the players' activity being shown here in the given political context. The results would be completely different if the same exercise had been conducted in a different background. I'd like you to have a look at the current context so that you understand what biodiversity means for farmers. And I think we are going to understand there are three ways to interpret this, in three very different ways. Biodiversity for farmers. Well, biodiversity is not a word that they readily use in their vocabulary. It's reminiscent of something that reminds us of environmental policies, and diversity is something rejected by the agricultural world. The agricultural world became aware of the stakes of biodiversity, and it watched the world of biodiversity emerge in its universe through nature conservation policies, such as the Habitat Directive and the Natura 2000 network. But they were experienced as being very stringent policies, antagonistic with agricultural policies, and they were generally rejected by the farming world. I have told you about the agricultural world as being a homogeneous world, and yet we know that there are tensions even among farmers. And the biggest divide is the one between those who promote agriculture with more integration in international capitalism and those who criticize agricultural modernization. The tension became crystallized in the 90s in the fight against GMOs. Following that, some actors in the agricultural world showed that a new movement was emerging for farmers to gain ownership of the seeds again. And they battled with the seed industry, and they looked at the diversity to find find all the local varieties, and some work was conducted regarding exotic and more rustic, more resistant seeds. So biodiversity is more than what we thought until now. It refers to cultivated plants and bred animal races or breeds. But metaphorically, it means two things: a different relationship with the with living beings that is not industrial in any way, and several agricultural models that these movements are trying to defend. In a recent period, ecologists have started looking at ordinary biodiversity, that is, biodiversity not limited to remarkable species and protected natural spaces. Biodiversity in daily life. Dans le fonctionnement des écosystèmes. And they looked at the role of biodiversity in the functioning of the ecosystem. In this context, the biodiversity term is now being appropriated again and interpreted again by a large part of the agricultural world, because living being processes can become auxiliaries for agriculture. And even more than that, if we think about the sums invested, the biodiversity agricultural observatory is trying to develop this type of policy with farmers. I hope I have shown you several forms of interpretation of biodiversity. I hope you understand that this is directly linked with the evolution of policies in the field of nature. And I would like to underline one point. If biodiversity was, for 25 years, the dominating feature in policies of nature, this is changing now. The term biodiversity is now in competition with a new type of framework, ecosystemic services. Here we have the IPBES, Intergovernmental Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services. Biodiversity is followed by ecosystem services. The multiples attempt to appropriate the term ecosystemic services is something that we need to keep track of in the future.